Here we are.
Yay!
I have the honor to introduce Pascal Gielen to you. I did already on Project Campus, I don't know if you saw it. There's a full biography on everything that he does. For us, it was only logical that Pascal would open our bootcamp because he is the founder of the concept of this program, which he started already, I think, 4 years ago.
Yes. So, a sentimental moment.
Yes. Yes. And it was quite a process. It was not easy to get this master going. Although we all believed in the content already from the beginning, in institutional ways it has its challenges. You can also look at the testimonial that he filmed for us, where he spoke about what his urgency was for this master to start anyway, and it was connected to the lectureship that you performed here for 8 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. You are a full professor in sociology and art. He's connected to the University of Antwerp, and you wrote a lot of books, and also edited a lot of books for the Arts and Society series published by Valise. I think that's enough. We want to hear you.
Okay.
Okay.
I was thinking before we start, if it's okay, because it's a big group, that we just do a round, that I have an idea of who you are, what your background is, and then I know who I'm talking to, is that okay? And I will end then by adding something to my own biography. Yeah.
Okay, so my name is Mami Izumi. I'm originally from Japan, from the west side in Japan, not from the capital, but Osaka. I have been living in Netherlands, in Maastricht, for 4 years now. I studied in Austria, in Salzburg. It was a dance school called SEE, Salzburg Experimental Academy of Dance. I graduated in 2014. I got a project in Maastricht, so I started to live here by this opportunity. My practice is dance, basically. I have been dancing since I'm 5. Since 2016, I started to also initiate a project, and mostly about dance, moving, also a bit of fashion design involved as well. I teach also here in Pontis for the theater students for the dance and movement research since this year. Voilà, this is short.
My name is Paul. I'm a teacher of directing here at the Academy of Theatre, and one of the teachers in this master.
My name is Melody, and I'm interested in the transformative power of performance and immersive theatre.
My name is Anya. I have a bachelor in fine arts, but I'm also interested in how I can create my own space.
Where are you from?
Where
are you from?
Well, I was born in Slovenia, I lived in Croatia, but I almost lived my whole life in the Netherlands.
I'm Bina, from Vienna, Austria, and I'm a Stud performer. I'm producing Stud Theater.
Stud?
Street theater.
A street, sorry.
Street theater. I'm also a drama teacher and cultural manager.
Okay. I'm Flora. I'm from Hungary / Brussels. And I'm a dancer. I also have education. I'm coming from movement and physical theater. And, I'm teaching dance on the side and. For 3 years, I would say, I also try to initiate projects and lead them through.
Hi, I'm Vicky. I'm from Greece. I studied psychology and then dance. And after that, I mostly teach and perform and choreograph a little bit. In Greece, mostly we live from teaching because there is not so much funding for artists in general. I am very interested in public space. Also, from apart from artistic view, also from social view, and always from a political kind of view. What else? I think that's the basic.
I'm Maria from Iran. I studied architecture, but I think I'm a performer since I was born, because performing is quite a lot.
My name is Guo Rui. I'm from China, so I studied dance, folk dance in Beijing Dance Academy, and I also studied contemporary dance in Brussels at Arts. So now I'm working as a freelance dance artist in China. Since 2014, I have been working with this idea of performing in public space. We have been working in different venues in public space, such as urban village and also some we call CBD center. So one, there are like many reasons to work on public space, but one of the main reasons for me is the form of dance has to change in order to fit in that new venue, this environment. So that's one of the most important reasons I'm interested to make a performance in public space with the form of dance.
Can you repeat your name so I missed your name?
Guo, you can call me Guo, G-U-O, but also that's my family name. I made this mistake in Brussels, so everyone call me Guo. So if you want to call me my first name is Rui, R-U-I.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay for the both, actually. Yeah.
Okay.
Because in China, people call me Guo, and then, so I got used to Guo, so. And that's a mistake. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Nikita. I'm from India. And I am into performance, dance, and theater. And my interest in the past few years has been more towards video works in public space. And I also work as an organizer and a curator for folk and traditional dance forms for India. Yeah.
I'm Amy, I'm from Antwerp, Belgium. I started as a photographer, but I've been involved into more tourist installations and a lot of co-creation with the people. I'm very active also with kids to extend photography as a second language to them. And actually these workshops now are also part of my way of creating art, so it's one big mix of things I do. And I want to translate my work now to the public space, not only in museums, but maybe transform photography and installations.
Okay. Hi, I'm Monique. I'm from the Netherlands, and I'm the artistic leader of EEL Theater Collective, and there we never work in the theater, but always in other spaces, so mainly public spaces. And we've been doing that for quite a while now, and I have an urgent need to get some new food and food for thought and content to give another layer to my practice. And furthermore, I'm a teacher in the Institute, and I teach creative thinking here and sometimes in other countries too.
My name is Hedwig, and I'm a singer, basically, but also I create theater. I studied music theater here at Fontys from 2007 to 2011, and last year I came back to start my master's in music theater, and I'm combining it now with the PBS master. I started this master basically because I missed some deepening in the music theater department. It's mostly based on musical and performing and not creating, and I really wanted to challenge myself more in that, and so I started that 2 years ago, and now I'm doing some projects on festivals and interactive theater, and I hope to find a way to blend music, theater, and performing public space together in some new art forms.
Second row.
The last row.
Anne-Marie?
Oh, yes. Okay, I'm Anne-Marie. I'm working as a teacher here at Fontys Dance Academy, but my main practice is dramaturgy with different choreographers. That's it for now.
I'm Elaine. I am a teacher at the Academy for Circus and Performance Art. I teach theater, I direct occasionally, and I teach dramaturgy as well.
I'm Anja Reinhardt, artistic leader of Bluestoff together with Yuri. And Bluestoff is making performances in public space and also engaged in social things, but also in the perception of space. That's the main focus.
And we are based in Holland.
Okay, I'm Bo, and I'm just filming this lecture, so...
Cool.
Hi, Bo.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm Pascal. Maybe I have to say still a little bit about myself to frame the lecture or to make the lecture also more understandable. But first of all, my background is not in the arts, it's sociology. But fairly fast in the 90s I was interested in sociology of culture, sociology of art. I made my PhD about contemporary dance and visual arts together. The main question was, why are people selected as an artist? So that was a kind of typical 90s question, I think. Why does art become art? But yeah, I get more and more interested, I think, during my studies and research in, of course, public space, but also especially politics, and also the way artists organize themselves in general, and how it is possible also to organize yourself in a kind of alternative context, for example, where there is not a market functioning, or where there are no subsidizing at all. What kind of models can you develop in this kind of context to make your work? And that's also still what I'm at the moment, the research which is running, what I'm doing. In fact, I'm doing two things. One is not the research, but is the coordinator, being the coordinator of research in the arts, PhDs, research lines. That's one thing. And the other is a research which is called Sustainable Creativity in the Post-Fordist City, in which we work with an interdisciplinary team of economists, policy experts, artists, musicologists, to find out how we can model new ways of organizing ourselves in society as creators, in the broader sense, going from designers, architects, to autonomous art. So this is a little bit what I'm doing at the moment. My lecture is positioned between two researchers, two books also, so this frames much more what I'm going to say today. One is something probably familiar to you, you've read it already, it's Interrupting the City, which was a book we made and asked the question, how can you as an artist constitute public space? What are the conditions of working in public space, but also how can you generate public space? The whole idea starts from the idea that public space does not exist, but that you have to make it again and again and again. I come to this later also, what this means. So important for me is public space is not something you can step in. It does not exist. You have to make it. A book which comes out and which was connected with the research, and that's where my lecture is in between now, is the book The Art of Civil Action. And this was an assignment of the European Culture Foundation to do research. They asked me the question, is there a kind of European, pan-European civil space possible, so transnational, because civil space is mostly related to a nation state, we come later to this. And again, of course, European Culture Foundation, what's the role of culture in it, the role of artists, organizations, and so on. For doing this, we traveled all around Europe, but also Turkey, etc., to look at artists, cultural organizations, etc., who made public space and who did it in a specific way. So what I will do now today means something you know already, and then I jump to the next research, what I did for ECF. By the way, this final outcome of this report and also the book, The Art of Civil Action, will be presented in November in the Singel in Antwerp, which is a symposium. It's all based on a symposium. It's called Between Creativity and Criminality. You see it already. And in which a lot of people who are invited to work in this kind of strange zone between creativity and criminality. One related to architects, I come later to them, is Recetas Urbanas, for example, in Spain, but also who comes as, I always have to look at her name, Nadia Tomakatova, she's the leader of Pussy Riot. So there are people who really do something with art. I don't discuss the quality of what they do about art, but always are in this between creativity and criminality. They take this risk to go in public space and to construct public space. And the last thing, it's also in the title, what interests me or what I see more and more, or we see in our research also with the different staff members, when we go to look at this kind of weird organizations which work between subsidizing and the market system, we were confronted ourselves in the research with what is called very trendy nowadays, the commons. So we call also a lot of organizations of the commons. What is this? I come later to this. But this is this kind of very weird in-between zone between the market and the state. Let's call it like that. But I come later to this, what I okay, let's go. I dedicate this lecture, like every lecture this year, to Mark Fischer. Mark Fischer wrote a lot with us. He published in several books in the Arts and Society series. But he committed suicide 13th of January of this year, so I promised myself that I dedicate every lecture, so also this lecture is from Mark. Mark is was very inspiring for my own work. A very well-known book of him is Capitalist Realism, but another book which I like much more and says much more about himself is Ghosts of My Life. And it describes, it's very much related to, I think, the subject matter also. He describes how the soundscape of London can make you depressive. So how the sounds and how a city is organized, and especially also the music which is played there, etc., can give you a kind of bad feeling. Public space. Okay, let's start. Let's start with this and some things you know, but I think also sometimes it's nice to hear it instead to read it, to make it more understandable. But also when you have immediately question, I like that you immediately interrupt me and ask questions that we can interrupt about things. So I focus today, first of all, in the first part on cities and the relationship between art and cities and what can be done there. This is a bird's view of Paris, part of Paris at least. And it is mentioned in a book of, a very old book for me. It's written in 1970, the year when I was born, so for me it's old. Of Richard Sennett, and it's called The Uses of Disorder. And he starts this book with a kind of blunt statement. He says, the huge problem, 1970s, and he's writing with, I think, in the back of his head, the city of New York, because he lives at that moment in New York. By the way, Richard Sennett was also a long time in the 80s advisor for the city board of New York about urban planning, etc. In his work, but he's a philosopher. And he says, as a kind of analysis in the 70s, he says there's a huge problem going on in our society nowadays. People don't get adult anymore. They stay in their adolescence. And the next thing he connects to this, what is then adolescence? So adolescence can be a very beautiful thing. I have one adolescent at my home now. But I also recognize immediately what he says about adolescence. Adolescents are, of course, in search for their identity. It's a typical moment in your life between 12 sometimes even already and 18 years old, where you are really in search for yourself. But by doing that, you get a kind of very stiff and rigid way of confirming yourself. You say principle, to define yourself against others, your parents in the first place, of course, etc. This is a quite normal, at least in Western countries, a quite normal process, this adolescence process. And it's also nothing wrong with it, but it is very problematic when you stay as an adult in your adolescence. And then he says this is the huge problem nowadays. People stay in their adolescence all their life. Why is it? What is the main reason for this? He mentions two things. Family life. How we build up our families, it makes that we stick in our adolescence. So he blames how the family structure is made, again in Western society. And second, how we build up our communities. And how do we do this, family life, building up communities, by constructing a kind of sameness around us. And this is literally where identitas in Latin stands for, it means the same. identitas. So we are looking again and again for the same in the other, the same in our context, same in our community, and we build communities around us of sameness. This is also how the city was structured from 19th century on by somebody like Baron Haussmann, who was responsible for lanes in Paris, who made a kind of blueprint of the city to reframe the city. I thought before I read this book of Richard Sennett always that it was a kind of functional thing to let the army in and out, but also to make it possible that there was fast traffic, so the functional city is organized by those lanes. But he had also other intentions, Haussmann, and it's also very well documented. He wanted to segregate different social classes, even different ethnic groups in the city. So those lanes had also another function. They made, in fact, a kind of city of enclaves, of different homogeneous, different social groups in the city. And especially those lanes are not public spaces, no, those lanes are really to get them that they are not confronted anymore with each other. Which happens more and more, I think he's talking in the 70s, by cars, etc., who occupy the street, and the street becomes not anymore a public space where you meet because there's huge traffic and it separates different parts of the city. So segregation, building up kind of communities, why also people get stuck in their adolescence in cities. What does Richard Sennett says? We need, in fact, the opposite. We need, instead of disorder, disorder. In cities. He, 70s, he mentioned even the word, and he uses the word a lot. We need more anarchy in our cities. I made of it later on agony. It means a kind of, it's not an agonistic relationship that you kill each other in the street, but that you can confront with the other, that you can highly dispute with the other, that you can have conflicts with the others in general. So it's very interesting, I think, what he says. He says, we need so this more disorder in this city, more conflict, literally in public space. Another question is, of course, why do you want this? And then comes very interesting in this book, I think, to avoid this. So we need more conflict in the street to have aggressive interruptions, disruptions, violence in the street. We need more conflict to avoid this aggressive space. This is 2011, London. I could take a lot of other city pictures which are representative for this, but I took this because I like the Billy Idiot's picture in the front. For me, this is the creative city. When we're talking about creative cities, this is the creative city. This is the flip side also of the creative city. So this is a city which promotes creative classes in cities, creative districts in cities, and at the same time makes inequality growing, and the gap between rich and poor growing and growing. That's the policy which is introduced already in the 90s in a lot of cities, starting with London, I think, where the whole policy was invented. And this is also, for me, this is the flip side. This is the same, how do you call it, there are the both sides of the same coin. Creative city and this kind of aggressiveness. Yeah.
I have a question about this thing that Sennett says to not have this happen. But is there also a wish for a certain equality in that coming from these conflicts in the city, or not?
Yeah, equality, but I come later to that when equality does not mean equal, similar, but equality certainly for what is always as a good democrat is fighting for is equality in an economical sense, but that means not homogeneity, and that's the difference I think in this argument. So it means instead of consensus, dissensus is very important for mental differentiation, but differentiation not in a beautiful, harmonious, multicultural way, but where the conflict is possible. Which is, of course, a kind of paradox. It means that you can regulate, in a way, conflict. This kind of,
I read it also in your article, and just give me this feeling of you can also somehow then organize privilege. I don't know, I'm just questioning if then you can actually break it, or if it's a way of somehow having these conflicts but still staying in your
bubble. At least his intention is to break open this bubble. So that's because the opposite, the bubble is what we see in a lot of cities, especially in Latin America or New Mexico or in Sao Paulo, is kind of how they call it, those closed communities with a wall.
Compounds
or something like that. Compounds, yeah, but I'm searching for another word. But with a wall around.
Gated communities.
That was what I'm searching for. But even what you see nowadays in a very in a modest way, also even in cities like Brussels, Antwerp, etc., where, for example, I just say something. 6 or 7 middle-class families decide to buy all the buildings in one street or one block and have a shared garden, but it's really, you see the cameras outside to a block of the street. So you see it also in a very small way, which are, in fact, indeed, communities which organize themselves. Again, what he is saying, when you do this, the risk that you get this grows and grows and grows. That's for me important, I think. When you segregate, make walls between, then you let in a way increase this kind of possibility for that. Okay, when we have this... just to mention, I could put here a lot of examples. I think I chosen this because of symbolic London, also why the riots were so high, but also for this Billy Elliot. But it happened also in the suburbs of Paris, Den Haag, I think, 1 year ago, in the Schilderskwartier, what's a nice name already, it's Schilderskwartier, so it means paintings quarter, where this riots happened. I could also take picture in a more modest way of Molenbeek in Brussels, or in Antwerp, the city where I live, the Turnhoutse Baan. It's a typical place where always guys, this kind, when there are riots, it's there. It's kind of one street, always. Where this kind of things happen. Anyway, then when this happens, a lot of politicians stand ready at this time, like camera. But I could put here also a picture of Sarkozy in this time, who literally talked about when this happened about the scum in the street. So this is very interesting, I think, this kind of moral finger which they are pointing up, and in fact saying kind of this is a kind of individual responsibility of the youth in the street, etc. So you get a kind of moral individual conviction of what is happening. Also mainstream media, it's not only I think politicians who blame Rutte in the Netherlands talked about achterlijke gladiolen, stupid, I don't know what gladiolen is anyway, but so they don't know, so this is for me very interesting, they don't know what to do with it, in fact. They have no name for it, they blame, they seem not to understand what is happening there, etc. But we know also when this happens, when this kind of debate is going on, this heated debate in media, in parliament, etc. Also another group stands up of intellectuals, philosophers. Here is the very old, he died I think a month ago, Sigmund Bauman, or 2 months ago, who always was pointing at here is something else going on than this kind of loss of morals. It was also a kind of idea of Cameron's big society, that we have to integrate again the youth and bring them morals, values back to the youth as a kind of solutions. People like that, this whole army says also no, no, no. They point also with a finger, but maybe in another way, and say no, it has to do with the crisis, and especially it has to do classical, I call it Marxist analysis of the problem. It has to do with social and economical inequality. And indeed, in a way they are right, as most of them sociologists, but also social geographers have proven in statistics, when the gap between rich and poor grows in the country, you get more this kind of clashes, violent clashes in your society. So it has to do certainly with this thing which is called always what they call a structural problem in society, so not a kind of emotional moral eruption of something, but it has a kind of structural base, and when we see this gap is growing and growing, we get more violence in cities. But until there, the analysis of, let's call it also, mainstream intellectuals who come up again and again to point at this kind of structural thing. In a way, they are certainly right, but I think also that they miss something in their analysis. And that is what we see, that there is also a kind of violence which grows even when there is huge equality in societies, but when there is enormous economic growth. And beyond a certain level, or over a certain level, we see coming up this kind of violence, what I call violence to the self. Depression, suicide, Mark Fisher in it. So this is something which is not related to a gap between rich and poor, or that there is more inequality in the city. No, it's well known that exactly the welfare states who had a huge welfare, economical welfare, that the suicide rate grows and grows. Also depression grows, burnout grows in those societies. Especially middle class, higher class people who commit suicide, get depressions, etc. In Belgium we are famous for that. In Belgium is one of the highest rates of suicides in whole Europe, at least. And especially was a report, I think, which was published 3 months ago, especially women who make a career are the hugest victims of this kind of violence. Interesting, Anna, what I forgot to say with the Cameron is also how they try to frame this kind of violence, also the violence in the street. First of all, I mentioned already that they convicted as a kind of moral problem, an individual problem also, but they also often don't know how to call the problem, and they point at it as senseless violence. This word is for me very important, senseless violence. In this sense is also depression, or at least committing suicide, has to do with the idea that you cannot make sense anymore of your life, or cannot make sense anymore of your environment in general. So it has to do something with sense. And this is for signification, meaningfulness, giving meaning to yourself, giving meaning to your context. What I want to say with this GDP, GHP means that a general development product does not equal a general happiness product. That's what we see, what is going on. So, but this made me thought that all those kind of mainstream intellectuals also, who say it is a structural problem, that they miss something in their analysis. And this is exactly this, the idea of sense, meaningfulness, etc. So what is the missing link? The missing link is culture. For me, I see culture in the broad anthropological sense. I see it as a huge bot with signs in, which you can take out to signify yourself. That's for me culture, and to signify your environment. Give meaning to your environment, give meaning to yourself in a certain context. Related to that, what is then for me art in it, and we can discuss this. It is one, at least one of the engines of culture. It is one practice in which we can bring in again and again new science in the bot, which is called culture, new meanings. New ways of trying to express ourselves, or of giving expression or representation of our society, again and again and again. I think art is, since modernity, at least is trying to do this. So, and that's also why I think it's a very important practice, in that sense, at least at a systems level, it keeps a culture dynamic. Again, it is only one practice, I think, which does this, but in a very, conscious way, I think, it's almost, in a systems theoretical way, the function of art for a broader society as a system. Okay, I go into a little bit deeper into culture, because here we come more and more, I think, also to what does it mean to operate in public space, or to make public space. For me, it's always relating to culture. You're doing something with culture when you go into public space, or when you make public space, with your art, with your performances, etc. So that's why also it's for me very important to understand culture process. I mentioned already I used a very broad anthropological way of defining culture, way of life. It's how we give meaning to our own lives, conscious and unconsciousness, I think, also, how we deal with things, how we rationalize, for example, why we are sitting here today. Why did you come to Tilburg to do this? This on the, what I mean is on a very basic, small level, small steps you take in your life are based on culture and are based, and you use culture also to take this kind of decisions, to navigate yourself in life. So I said already, it's all about giving meaning to human existence in society. But I mean this, I take this very, I would say almost emotional, at least affect-laden. It's what I saw, for example, in classical definitions in sociology also, of culture, by the way, which was articulated by my former supervisor of my PhD, he had also a kind of definition of culture. He mentioned also the bot of science, in which you can take things out, but it stayed with us. So they had a very symbiotic definition of what culture is. It's only kind of almost formal thing of signifying, a signifying system in it. I add to this, signifying is also meaning, and it really affects yourself. It means also values, of course, you believe in, and they are really affected to yourself. You get embedded in the culture, you feel comfortable. It's culture which you make, you feel, which can transform a house to a home. That you feel at home is a very important relationship. So it gives you kind of, it's effect loading, but that means also you can have a lot of conflicts, of course, around culture, because you want to defend sometimes culture. And I think this is the main the central definition of classics like Sigmund Freud defined culture like that, but also Martin Heidegger defined culture like that. His answer to why do we have culture was Sein zum Tode. Because we know we are going to die, we have culture. Because we know we are going to die, we start questioning what I'm doing here, of course. And that's the starting point, I think, and that's the basis also. That's also one of the reasons we are doing another book, No Culture, No Europe. Why not? Economy is the base of a society, but culture, it's really where we're standing on. To define economy, to define politics, to define, for example, a concept as democracy, which is in fact a cultural concept. It is a way of signifying, it's the base on which we stand. So it's also putting also marks on his head, literally, saying not culture is the superstructure, no, it's the base on which we stand. But it's also putting neoliberalism on his head, which also says neoliberalism or liberalism, which really sees, in fact, the economical system, the market, as the base on which we stand. We say, no, 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 it is culture. So this means also, literally, when you, and I say it is a belief, it's an ideology, even if you want, but this shift is very important to understand, I think, your own possibilities as a signifier, as an artist, to make things, and to generate new ideas, and to reframe, for example, to intervene also in public space. I think, again, artists are, we call it main signifiers, or something like that. Try to signify again and again. And you are schooled in doing this. You have the best skills, I think, to do this. A little bit back to what are the functions of culture, or what are different ways cultural actors in general, going from museums to schools, I think, which is a very important cultural actor, what they do in society is in fact a lot of things, but you can, in a way, in an analytical way, reframe it to three basic roles which those cultural actors, including artists, do in culture. One is a very classical one is socialization. Socialization means for me literally bringing people in a social order without questioning the order. So it means literally giving your baby the breast as a mother. Literally, it's bringing somebody in a social order, saying which the good books are to read, putting on the television or not putting on the television, giving them a computer or not giving them a computer. But it's also, my girlfriend, for example, in Antwerp works for integration, it's also all those refugees and immigrants. When you want to have a job here, you need to do this and this and this. And politeness means that in our society or in Antwerp. So this is the whole process of socialization. Again, showing and introducing even people, or integrating even people in a social order without questioning this order. And which is, again, it sounds critical, but it's very, very important, is the base. When you don't have this, you get bottomlessness. You need to stand on something which is a base, which gives yourself a fundament to stand on. And to feel comfortable and to get in bed with, literally, on the ground, solid ground. Second, qualification. Qualification is a process of making hierarchies, saying this is better art than that, but also saying to students, you get an 8 at 10 and you get a 7 at 10. There's also a qualification of you are better than, or this paper is better, or this performance is better, as the jury does, again. So making hierarchies is the process of qualification. Making the art historical canon is a process of qualification. And we can even say, after postmodernism, this is this high and low culture, this collapses now, it's merging itself. I doubt, but anyway, what we see is also on a very individual subjective level, you do this again and again. You say, this is better than that. Very basic. So you make your own hierarchies also, and again, and we do it also together in discussions with each other, in liking and disliking on Facebook, etc. So we really perform, literally, qualification processes in the culture every day. It's also what is in the news and what is not in the news, is not making an hierarchy, etc. Again and again. So qualification processes is also a basic function of what we do in culture. And the last one is subjectification. It's this, hitting somebody in the face, for me, subjectification. It means that you confront yourself or you confront somebody else with his or her own subject. Who are you? What are you doing here? It is the moment, for example, when you get a divorce after 10 years, you start questioning, who am I, what I'm doing here, what was my life about? But it is also the moment that's maybe more interesting, it's also the moment when you have a new relationship and you are 3 months with each other and you start questioning, where am I in this relationship? That you feel determined by the other completely. This is also a moment that you try to find out who am I as a subject. That's the process of subjectification. And I think a lot of art, again since modernity, tries to do this, hit us in the face. By putting another sign in culture, confrontation with, and it can be very basic, another form, another color, another structure. It's also that, so it's not all but having political activist stuff or something like that. It can be very small things. It can be a street which is related to another place and that you have to walk in the morning to another part. So subjectification has really to do with this confrontation, it is also, and it's the moment when you start questioning the social order which came up with socialization. And that's the first thing. So you start, oh, my social order is today a little bit different. It can be very little thing, but it can be a harsh thing like a divorce, etc. But my order is changed, and now I have to reconfirm and have to re-socialize also myself again in the structure. That's the whole dialectics between, I think, subjectification and socialization. Sorry.
Well, I just was wondering, but I think you already answered the question, whether it is an interactive process, like it's not just somebody or something that confronts you. It is the interaction with the subject, and the subject has to feel confronted and has to start thinking. It's the interactive process.
It's like in art world, an art world does not exist, it's only in the eyes of the believer. That means also what for one is a confrontation is for another totally not. And this is also what you often see, I think, in kind of activist art nowadays, etc. A lot of people of the 60s say to you, oh, we've seen this already. It's, for us, it's socialization, it's not subjectification at all, or something like that. So, it is really dependent on your own life, your own biography, your own cultural context also in which you grew up, etc. Yeah, I was thinking about an anecdote. I gave a lecture a year ago in Amsterdam, and I started also with these adolescents, and there were immediately people who were not did not agree, because they thought adolescence is also a beautiful thing, which is also kind of which breaks open, etc. But anyway, to illustrate this, somebody of the public jumped in front of me and said in the public, "See, I can do this here." So this means that I can be subjective immediately, etc. And the rest of the public says, yes, you can do this in the Netherlands, and it's so evident what you do now. So this is the whole very, to say it's cultural bound. It's totally, maybe you cannot do it in Iran or something like that. It's just my cliches and projections on, but anyway, this is, so it's very cultural bound, but also related again to your own, how you were, how you grew up, your family life, your background. But, and now I come more and more in line with the subject, I think, again, how art was defined since modernity, starting in the west of our globe, let's say it like that, is very much related to what I call civil action. Its similarity is in the subjectification process. Again, also to say this, I think to be defined nowadays as an artist, and I make also a little bit of a cliche of it, means that you need to do something different, otherwise you're not an artist. I don't say that you do something different, but it needs to be perceived that you do something new, transgressive, something else than is done before. Authenticity has to do, is for me related to that. So it's almost in the core of the definition of our understanding, again, since modernity, of the artist, that you subjectify. That's your role. How we are framed more and more. I know there are artists who discuss this, and it can be certainly. But I think it is almost a kind of ethical core or something like that of the ontology in the arts. Okay, and this is probably well known of the text. Now I relate those things with each other. So civil action, politics, city environment or urban environment, and the arts, how are they related, etc. That means also that I, in a way, reframe the story of Richard Sennett by another theoretician. It's called Michel de Certeau. And I always lost the title of his book. It's not, I think it's The Uses of Everyday Life, anyway, in which he frames and almost says the same as Richard Sennett. He's not going, he does not analyze violence in streets, but he tries to analyze how daily life is lived in a social order, and more exactly a city. And he makes a much more, and that's why I wrote it, a much more analytical or conceptual analysis of this by making a classical structural opposition between two concepts. And he does this two times. One is strategy, the other is tactics. Strategy stands for making a blueprint, long-term thinking, doing research about urban planning, and then Baron Haussmann, making your print. That's a strategy in long term, making it first also on paper, discussing it with other people maybe, etc. That's strategy. Tactic is using what is happening then in a different way. And always, it can be in different ways, it can be squatting a place, it can be a square which is made for a market every Sunday, but the skaters coming, using the place in a technical way. It can be pub owners in Amsterdam who use those Amsterdammertjes, those to put on the table, to use it for their own pub, to make a terrace at the street. So it can be in different ways. Can be used in a commercial way also, it can be used, but this is tactical use, reusing and reusing the place for how it's meant, for how it was meant before, and rearticulate it, taking it in your own terms also. It's for me very important. The other opposition which he makes is between place and space. Place is a fixed place, it's where a monument is standing or where building is standing, that cannot stand something else. It's predefined. It's fixed place. While space is, as he called it, is always emplacement. It means always emplacement. You make again and again and again the place by acting. That's space. When you cross them, and then I make my own grid of it, you get a kind of ideotypical way at looking to the relationship between politics, arts, and the city. Strategical place, classical Haussmann, Haussmann city, the monumental city. A city which has its marks, its monuments, and the place of art in the city is also monuments. Artists are responsible and also respected for national monuments they make. But also they are locked up in monumental buildings. The opera building, theater building, museums, etc. In general, that's their place, location in the, let's say, 19th beginning of the 20th century city. So fixed place and in a kind of strategy put there for a long term. I make a kind of chronology of it, but in fact, I come later to this, all those things exist next to each other, and some cities nowadays still are more a monumental city, or maybe more another kind of city. But response to this end of the 1950s, 60s, is what I call the situationist cities, related to the situationist who made a situation in the city. What do they do? A lot of actions in the city, going public, trying to reframe, at least they attacked in a tactical way, the monumental city. Walking naked through the streets, organizing happenings, manifestations also. It's also well documented that the situationists in fact prepared the huge 1968 revolution of students, etc. In that sense they invented the tactics to do this, and the posters, the graphically to organize. So, but what they're doing is for me interesting to frame it also, is they use tactics indeed in a hierarchical, structural, rigid place. They fight this. They fight also institutions, try to break it open. Democratization, institutional critique, for example, in the visual arts, against museums, etc., to democratize in the Netherlands, they had Action Tomato, in which they threw tomatoes to the classical theater at this moment. It's also fighting against hierarchies, fighting against socialization, social order at this moment. Fighting against the hierarchy in universities also, bureaucracy there, etc. So this is the moment of kind of friction, which is for me very interesting, but it is also quite well dated. It's a certain moment, I think, in time. And to say now a little bit blunt, the situationists won. They made literally the city liquid. They made it movable, etc. But of course they won in a very selective way, or they were interpreted and in a very selective way. It's not what I think De Boer, to call one of the most famous situations, had in mind, of course, what could happen after this. But what is happening in the 60s, and what is for me very important when you look at this revolt, you see, it's an analysis, not of me, it's of Poltanski and Thévenot. They describe it in the New Spirit of Capitalism. They describe, in a way, how the 60s revolution failed, between brackets, in a way. And they say, in fact, there were two revolutions at that moment. There was a social revolution, the workers. And there was a student revolution, what they call the aesthetic revolution. And those two are, of course, sometimes in their eyes, or in their analysis, sometimes together on the street, but most of the time not. They have another agenda, another strategy, and they sometimes come together. But there is a kind of segregation between the two agendas, and they say exactly it is the students who were then on the street who in fact become later on the new managers, the new CEOs, the new policy makers of this new city, which I call the Greater City, in the 80s, 90s. They come also the, like we call them nowadays, the anarcho, so the anarchist capitalists of real estate, which made literally cities liquid in the 80s. When I visited for, I grew up, said already, I was born in 1970, and I visited in a very small town called Maasmechelen in Belgium. So I visited the first time cities when I was 14, 15 years old, and what I recognized immediately there, or what even afraid me a little bit at that moment was that they were always under construction. They were always somewhere building in the city, etc. So it was, the city was a kind of on the move. It was made liquid. I didn't realize, of course, what was happening there and why it was. But I think until today, still, they are building in cities. It never ended, this kind of... and it's not only building, it is also giving buildings another destination. Yeah.
This sort of implies that that has started in the 70s, and in my conception I had that, like, this is happening from whenever we started building cities, that they have been under construction all the time. So how does that relate to what you're saying?
Yeah, sure. First of all, it was me who came from the countryside to the city, of course, and was confronted with this. But there is a kind of, there are statistics also about it, what happens in cities. Saskia Sassen did this in global cities, for example. And we see enormous increase in the 70s of construction plans, rebuildings, reframing cities, etc. It had sometimes to do with practical reasons. The car, who came more and more in, of course it was already there, but they had to find solutions. But it had also to do with two very important things, and I'm thinking about the order to put them. I first take the very abstract order. And that means, this is the analysis of Saskia Sassen. She says in 72 something very important happens. The Bretton Woods system is broken down. At that moment, by one decided decision, by the way, by the United States. What is the Bretton Woods system? I say it very blunt, I'm not an economist, so I cannot go into details, but that means that money is related to gold. And there was a kind of, what was the name of the jail where this gold was stuck in the United States somewhere? I don't know anymore. It's a very famous one. I think it was Alcatraz. But anyway, so they had, every nation state in the world had his amount of gold in this. And when there was a kind of inflation in the country related to another country, they literally put the gold from one jail to the other, the other nation country. So there was a kind of relationship between money and gold, material relationship. This system is broken down in 72, literally. What does this mean? Because I think, yeah, it means nothing. It means literally that money became immaterial and much more liquid, could flow over the world very easy, or more easy at that moment. And that makes also, here comes Saskia Sass in, that it concentrates in cities. More and more, it's sucked up, and a lot of that's very important. A lot of nation states concentrate in megapolis, etc., where they concentrate the money. This city in London is an example where all the world is represented in the financial system. So what is here happening by this? Money is literally made liquid. And what happens also, you get artificial and virtual ways of concentrating money. And then you have two things. People follow the money. They go where the money is, where they can make money. And you get enormous immigration flows starting from the 70s. So also the city on this level becomes more and more liquid, movable. And then the other thing what I wanted to say, and I don't know yet where it comes from, but in urbanism you see that the whole idea and also the concept of project development starts in the 70s. What is project development? A project is temporary. So project developers, real estate, started to speculate on buildings in cities. And what is interesting now, and what is then the relationship with this hyperfluid or liquid money, is that the buildings also follow the money. That means that when you have speculation on buildings, it means that, and this is, sorry, this is a very classical technical Marxist distinction, that means that exchange value becomes more important than use value. A use value means that you can live in a building, that's nice, that there is good mobility in the city, that you can move, etc. That's it's livable. That's the use value of it. Exchange value means just quantifying money. And so what you see is that exchange value in real estate becomes more and more important. So it's not important anymore that you, of course, it's yeah, I will come to this later. What is the most important is that you can make money of a building. That's a completely other definition of a building than you want a good office to work nice, or a good studio, or a home to live in. And of course, this is still important. And this is what the creative city, by the way, is promising, a nice environment to be creative, etc. But it is reframed not as this is use value, a nice environment to be interactive and see other creatives, etc. But what is predominant in it is exchange value. This means also when it's not attractive enough for a highest bidder, you just sell it. And then you make buildings liquid. So this means also that it is less and less and less impossible to embed yourself on the long run in a place somewhere, to integrate you in a place. And the whole extremist nowadays that, for example, people in New York, in the center of New York, buy an apartment for $6 million and they only are there 2 weeks a year. This is the super rich. But and what you get on the ground is no shops anymore because they don't use shops. You see kind of complete desperate deserts starting up in Manhattan. Central is now enormously growing, this kind of not used and not lived space. So use value is completely unimportant almost, or is reduced enormously in this. And this is, I think, what is happening in the 80s, 90s, especially 90s when this creative city comes up, when districts, buildings and cities have enormous exchange value, then it's important, and that's what politicians try to do, it's important that you bind the money to your city. And that's what you try to do. And there the whole concept of creative cities, creative industries comes in. That's the moment. Because they want to bind money to the city, a kind of economy. This is very much influenced by theories of Richard Florida, for example. Creative Class is a book. Know Your City is one of his main important books. And I think Richard Florida is still very, how do you call it, nuanced in his analysis. He says also this is the positive and this is the flip side of it, or the back side of it, when you invest in creative cities. But he stimulates this analysis. He says you need a creative district as a new economy. It's very important. And for this you need free peace. That's an old classical story. You need tolerance. You need so many homosexuals in your city, etc. But those districts are important. One main thing is he made this analysis only for very metropolitan cities, but interesting, it is copied almost blind by policy makers everywhere. We made a kind of analysis of only the Netherlands in 2011 of what was standing in cultural reports, cultural plans of communities, so not only cities, but all the communities in the Netherlands. Only two of the communities did not mention Richard Florida. So it is in a very selective way implemented, and this is the the creative city.
Also, he actually came here.
He came here also
in Eindhoven. He just made a tour in Holland 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Just to sell his.
Sell a thing, and he was invited. This is interesting. He, by the way, before I forget, he has written just a month ago a book with a big mea culpa, in which he says it's not true. In that sense, he says my speculations on the future, because it was kind of speculative thing, doesn't work. But he says again, I said also it does not work for example, middle region cities or something like that. But he says also it, and one thing is what is in the book here, which he analyzes also, he says again, the gap between rich and poor grows and grows and grows in the system, and the poor are putting out to the suburbs in the cities, and you get a new kind of, clashes, literally. But in the meantime, all those governments, and still, I know that I was teaching in Groningen for 10 years, and next to the room where I teach, they were literally building a creative district from ground zero. It's already bankrupt now. That is what happens with all those investors who enter to stimulate this. For me, symbolic, this becomes a kind of official policy, also, by the way, by the European community. You see now everywhere in the cultural plans are not anymore cultural policy plans, it's creative. Cultural plans, but it starts, I think, symbolic, very symbolic, when Tony Blair, the former is it prime minister,
mm-hmm.
of the UK, embraced Bono View 2 for the cameras. That's the moment that says, okay, creative industries is kind of where we invent. It's an economical tool, and he starts also inventing policy plans, etc. This is 90s. Most of the governments of those cities are socialist governments. Tony Blair was not the mayor of London at this moment, but it was also, as I'm right, a socialist government. But it was also a socialist government in Antwerp, for example. It was certainly in Groningen. Etc. And this is what they call also the so-called third way socialism. It's a socialism who does not fight anymore against market mechanisms, but try to correct them. Third way embraces the market, says this is the only way, there is no alternative market structure, but of course we have to correct it with a kind of welfare. It's, by the way, a sociologist who was the thinker or made this plan, it's Anthony Giddens, who was the advisor of Tony Blair at that moment. Why I start with the socialists? Because in the years 2000 happened something very interesting in most of those cities. You get a completely other party politics, another party comes in, neoconservatives, the neocons. In a lot of cities, get in charge. In Antwerp, we had the NVA, the Nationalist Flemish. Is it Nationalist or New Flemish Alliance?
New
Flemish Alliance, neo nationalist group. We had it also in London at the same moment. And they also, this is interesting, I think, because for economical reasons, they also embrace the creative city, but they also introduce zero tolerance at the same time. They fight or try to fight in a very repressive way against criminality, drugs dealing, for example, more cameras in the street, etc. And at that moment you get a very interesting mixture. For me, a very paradoxical one, but also, for me as a sociologist, a very beautiful one, almost, to analyze, to see what is happening. Because you see at one part, you see a kind of promotion of creative freedom, do what you want, become also a freelancer, also like that, but also take your own responsibility Be Active Citizens, Cameron, etc. At the same time, the grew of control, more and more in the cities. Same time, the army in the streets in Antwerp, before terrorist attack, by the way, in Brussels. So you see this kind of very strange, more blue on the streets, more policemen on the streets. So you see literally this system. I think that's the moment in which you are living now. Most of cities are organized in this kind of paradoxical way. Yeah. Embracing freedom, also even saying to stimulate it, give it to the market, make your own business and organize your own creativity, do what you want, but at the same time, that's it. It's another book and it's another lecture in which I use this, but it was beautifully illustrated by in the beginning of 2000, still a socialist mayor in Antwerp, by the interventions of the artist Benjamin Verdonk, who did in 2009, I think it was, a project which was called Kalender in the city. So we did interventions in the city. But what is interesting is that before he started doing this, so he decided this year almost every day or every Saturday I do interventions, he had a kind of meeting with a lot of actors in the cultural field sitting around the table, and also politicians were there, stakeholders, but also the mayor of Antwerp, at that moment a socialist mayor Patrick Janssens. And what is interesting is in this meeting that he is saying almost everything what he's going to do in the city, which his plans are, which kind of activist action sometimes it were just funny things, sometimes it were really with a political message. For example, he worked with illegals to fight for their legalization or recognition in the city of Antwerp, where at that moment I think still 20% voted for Flemish Bloc, so the Flemish Belang, the extreme right. So that was very political and subversive, even I think, to do this in the city. So he presented all those plans at a meeting like this with those people. And at the end, in this film, there's a documentary made of it. It's nice also to post it, I think, to see it, because it's all about art in public space and making art in public space. At the end of the meeting, the mayor has to go away a little bit earlier, but before he does it, he comes to Benjamin Verlosky. It's kind of, it's a little bit critiqued. It's nice to have him in our city. While he was, in fact, criticizing part, at least, of the policy of the mayor himself. And you know this. This is repressive tolerance. This is a whole system in which, with which I think more and more becomes excluded nowadays, authoritarian, but still mayors play with this. Anyway, again, creative repressive city, is in which we are today, it's which is our condition. And my question is then, and this is speculative, this is utopism maybe, can there be a kind of other way of relationship between artists, politics, the city, public space in general, which I call very trendy, the common city. I don't know even if this is the right word, but I try to explain later what this is about.
Just break. A question, is it time for a 10-minute break?
Mm-hmm. Also for me. It's great. Yes.
2 cigarette break.
Two?
2 cigarette break.
2 cigarette break.
15 minutes.
One bucket.